In this video, we're going to take a look at one of the more complicated topics covered in Calculus 1, Riemann sums and definite integrals. So here's the idea. We've been talking about how we find the area under the curve, and we haven't been able to do that exactly yet, but we have been relying on approximations, where what we do is we take rectangles and we squeeze it under the function, a number of them, 6 or 8 or 10 or 20 of them, and then based off of the areas of these rectangles, we can add up the areas of the respective rectangles. And when we add them together, it gives us a rough approximation to the exact area under the curve. Well, today I want to move beyond this approximation and get to where we find the exact area under the curve and not rely on an approximation anymore. All right, so before we begin, I've just got a few technical details to run through. All right, for these functions, they're going to be defined on a closed interval. So they'll be defined on like 2 to 5 or 1 to 7 or something like that. The width of each of these intervals here is going to be dictated by how many rectangles you have and what the length of the interval is. So the width is going to be b minus a divided by n, which the b minus a figures out how long your interval is, and then divided by the number of rectangles that you have, that'll determine the width of each subinterval here. All right, as I just said, n is going to be the number of rectangles. And now this is going to be a confusing one. I'll have to clarify this a little bit later. But in a given subinterval, so look at my cursor here, 1, 2, look at the third subinterval that I've drawn. X sub I star, so X sub 1 star, X sub 2 star, X sub 3 star, that's going to stand for any X value in the first or second or third subinterval. So when you choose an I, like the third subinterval right here, X sub 3 star will stand for any X value within that third subinterval. Now, what are we doing with that? We'll get to it in a minute. But using these definitions here, we're going to try to converge to the exact area under the curve rather than getting approximations. Okay, so I've halfway filled out this definition just to speed things along, but here we go. The definite integral of a function on an interval from A to B is defined as this. It's a tall s, this is called an integral symbol, from A to B, so these are called your limits of integration, of f of x dx. And I've got more to write, but let me just stop here for a minute. This symbol notation, it means the exact area under the curve from A to B under the function f of x. Okay, so that's what this notation is standing for here. Now, how would you find this in theory? Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to make a sum of the areas of each of these rectangles, like here on the left-hand side. Okay, so here's a summation notation. All right, the sum from I equals 1 to n. Now, you remember n is the number of rectangles. So if you have 6 rectangles, this would be the sum from 1 to 6, adding up the 6 areas of the 6 rectangles. And each rectangle, how do you compute its area? Well, if you recall, it's width times the height of each rectangle. Now the width is going to change the height is going to change rectangle to rectangle, but the width will always be delta x, if you recall, that b minus a over n. Now the height is going to change depending on what interval you're in. Now as you choose an x, the height of that rectangle is f of x, right? Because it goes as high as the function for each subinterval. So it's going to be f of some x value. Now, what x value do we want to take? Well, if you remember, there's lots of different ways to do this. You can have a left-hand sum or a right-hand sum or an upper sum or a lower sum. We don't want to mess with all those. We're going to let the x value be some abstract generic x value, x sub I star, which if you recall, that was the x value that we could choose anywhere within the ith subinterval. And so this would give you a width times height, which would give you the area of the ith rectangle, and we're going to add up all n of them. So you might add up the areas of all 6 rectangles or something. Now, if you look right there and you were to stop there, you might want to call me out on something. You might say, well, Devin, if you choose the left x value versus the right x value of a given subinterval, wouldn't that change your answer? Well, yes, it would. That would definitely give you a different answer depending on if you made the x value the touch at the left-hand side versus touch the function on the right-hand side. You would get more or less. But it turns out that's not going to matter. And here's why. If you stopped right here, this wouldn't be the exact area anyways. There's error involved. You see right here, we have tons of error on the high side or on the low side, etc. So let me ask you a question. How do you think we could improve on this approximation here with these six rectangles? Well, hopefully you'd say, well, try 12 rectangles or 100 rectangles or 1,000 rectangles. And that's certainly true. The more rectangles you have, the better the approximation becomes. So here's what we're going to do. Being that this formula here is if you have n rectangles, let's take the limit. Let's take the limit as n approaches infinity. And what that's going to do is that's going to take your interval and chop it up finer and finer and finer and finer. And as these intervals get chopped finer and finer, you'll see there becomes less and less choices for x because it just becomes narrow and more and more narrow in each subinterval. And so this will wind up converging to the same quantity regardless of whether you choose your x values on the left-hand side or the right-hand side or in the middle of each respective subinterval. So this limit notation is basically just going to add more and more and more rectangles. Imagine like a computer animation where you just added more and more rectangles in here and it'll converge to be this exact area here. I mean, you can imagine if you had just 1,000 little rectangles here, how good the approximation would be. But then move from 1,000 to 10,000 to 100,000 to 1,000,000. And as you approach infinity, this limit right here will converge to the exact area. Now, as we know from earlier in the semester, not all limits exist. So we're going to say that this is equal, assuming that the limit exists. Okay, so that's important here. Now, what does this guy do? Well, he gives the exact area under the curve. If you can find this limit, you can find the exact area under the curve. All right, a couple little side comments here. This guy at the tail end of the sum, they're just the sum, not including the limit part. This guy right here has a special name. He's called a Riemann sum. A Riemann sum, that's an important word to know. And as you take the limit as n goes to infinity of these Riemann sums, this limit converges to the actual area. Matter of fact, this word sum, that's why this symbol looks like an S. That S is for sum, it's an elongated S. And that's why that symbol, math symbol, was chosen for area under a curve. All right, now this guy on this side, this guy, he's called a definite integral. So that's a good word to know as well. So we often compute definite integrals of functions, which is computing the exact area under the curve on a given interval. Okay. As I already said, if this limit exists, your function is called integrable. This guy is called integrable. Not every function is integrable, only certain functions are integrable. Okay, now here's a, you might have another question for me. You might say, okay, Devin, I get what you're saying. You want to take more and more rectangles, and the more that you take, it converges to the actual area. I buy all that. Great idea, but how do you actually do this? Like, if somebody actually handed you a function and said, here, find the exact area under the curve, what do we do? Because you can't physically take more and more rectangles. I can find the area of six rectangles, and if you give me some time, maybe even 60, but I can't find the area of 6,000 or 600,000. You just can't do that. So, how do you actually do this pencil and paper? Well, that's a great question. And I'm not going to answer it in this video. There's actually, a couple different ways you can do this. The big thing that we're going to study in the upcoming videos is there's a way to do this using calculus. Now, we're not going to study that in this video. That'll come a little bit later. But I am going to show you one quick example where we do this on a calculator. Now, this is kind of, I won't say cheating, but this is not the way we're typically going to do it. I just want to show you quickly. Just while I have you, just to illustrate this concept here. So here what we're going to do is find the area under the x squared function from 2 to 4. So as the x's range, we know what this looks like. Here's x squared As the x's range from 2 to 4, I want to find the area under this curve exactly, not an approximation. Okay, so let me show you how to do this on the calculator real quick. All right, so what I've done is I went ahead and graphed x squared. You just go into y equals and push graph and maybe adjust your window here. And the button you're looking for is if you go to second calc, look at number 7 here. It's got that S, it's got that integral symbol. And so I'm going to choose number 7. And that's going to ask me two questions. It's going to ask me, what do you want to be your lower limit? And what do you want to be your upper limit? So I want the lower limit to start at 2, and then I want the upper limit to be 4. That's where I want to stop. Okay, you push enter, it'll sketch it, and it turns out this answer is 18 and 2/3, 18.67 approximately. So we can approximate this area here to be approximately 18.67, and that's the exact area under the curve, not some approximation. I'll bet you, and you can try this at home, if you did like an upper sum or lower sum of this function here on this interval with like 5 or 6 rectangles, the upper sum would give you probably 19 and something, the lower sum would give you 17 and something, and the exact area would be somewhere in the middle, namely 18.666 repeating. So anyway, that's great to know, but the key thing for us going forward is how do you do this by hand? And there's a slick way to do this. It's called the fundamental theorem of calculus. So if you want to go ahead and fast forward to that video right now, we will go ahead and cover that topic.